Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for this opportunity to preach your word. I pray, God, now that as we stand behind this sacred desk, in this sacred space, that you might speak to the hearts of these your people. For God, I realize that the only way that we will live is that we be fed bread from heaven. So open now the crystal fountain and let the healing waters flow. Give us that anointing that make preaching possible and practical. But God, none of that would be possible unless you send down the power from on high. So God, I pray that you use me again for your glory. Let none of me be seen, but all of you be heard. We thank you now, God, for this wonderful privilege to preach your gospel. And I thank you now in Jesus' name. And those who love the Lord said, amen. 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 What a beautiful day it is to be in God's church. Amen. Wow. Youth and children, you blessed us this morning. The book of John, chapter 13 this morning. John, chapter 13. The book of John, chapter 13. Just want to begin reading there at verse 34. Before we all decide to jump on to breathe too bad, he got a legitimate excuse this morning. He had a car breakdown, so you know, you're all right this morning. Because I was getting a little warm too, but I'm cool down now. I'm cool. John chapter 13, 34 through 38. It says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. But this shall all men know, that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. Simon Peter said unto him, Lord, whither goest thou? And Jesus answered him, whither I go, thou canst not follow me now, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. Peter said unto him, Lord, why cannot I follow thee now? I will lay down my life for thy sake. Jesus answered him, wilt thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall crow till thou hast denied me thrice. But just jump up and just look there at 34. It says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. I'm happy this morning, and I want to preach from this thought, enough evidence to be convicted. Tell your neighbor, enough evidence to be convicted. Yesterday, while I was in the big city of Bladenboro, my hometown, I had to go down and preach a eulogy on a very dear friend of our family. And I left Charlotte early, did my long drive. And you cannot go to Bladenboro without stopping at a little spot, little hole in the wall called Pauline's. There, I get this cheesy bag with this cheeseburger that's in that bag, and you can see the grease. There's no mistake about that. But that's a good cheeseburger. And I got the cheeseburger and I said, well, I'm going home, going to mama's. But I knew that being who my mama was, she was had something too. So I had a cheeseburger and I had some of mama's cooking. And she has this new thing going on, because she used to just watch soap operas. Now she's watching Law and Order. So I walk in the house and I say, hey mom, and she says, hey Sam. And so she says, are you hungry? I said, well, you know, I just ate this cheeseburger. She said, well, I got some food for you. It was smelling pretty good. So I said, yeah, I'm ready to eat. So I'm sitting there eating, and while I'm eating, I'm asking my mom questions, and she's acting like I'm not even in the room, because I said, Mama, she said, what, Sam? What? I'm watching Law and Order. And so I said, well, so I'm sitting there watching Law and Order with her. And then it dawned on me why she likes the show so much. And then we started gauging this conversation, and in this, it sparked about when I was in high school, the Department of Juvenile Justice had this program called Teen Court. And I remember I had sparked an interest in Teen Court, and I applied to be a part of the program, and I was accepted in. And you had the choice of picking if you wanted to be a defense attorney or a prosecuting attorney. And so I chose to be the prosecuting attorney. But then there were some cases where I wanted to be the defense attorney, because I felt like I could probably defend that person much better. But then there were times where I just wanted to be the prosecutor, because I was like, you know what? Forget this. No wonder why sometimes me and Nicole get into these heated arguments. She wanted to be the prosecutor and I want to be the defender. Y'all gonna help me in here? But either way, in teen court, it was a problem-solving court, because delinquent acts, and they were minor infractions and small misdemeanors that the persons could go through the program, and then they could be able to come out without having a criminal record. But it all depended upon, or it all was in the energy of what that person put into it. Because if they didn't put anything into the program or took the program seriously, then they would in turn have to go before the actual judge and receive whatever the verdict was. So it was much better for them to go through teen court than to go through their regular court. And while I was coming back last night, it hit me in my spirit that I should just hold court this morning in church. That I should just set this whole stage up like a courtroom real quick, and to make a case, and to make an arguable case, because there's probable cause with reasonable grounds to take this case to court this morning when you look in the text, because the prosecuting attorney has all the evidence and all the grounds to present this case to the grand jury in court this morning, and we have a few testimonies from an eyewitness, witness is much different than an expert witness. You got an eyewitness, and John is the eyewitness, and so there's a testimony to be seen in this text this morning, because there's a conflicting emotions that John is dealing with in this particular text, because he's happy and sad at the same time. He don't know if she should pull or if he should push. John is having conflict and emotions. He's up and he's down. He's left and he's right. He's with you and he's not. He knows what's to come, but he's not sure as to how to handle what's next. And I'm sure there are so many in the sanctuary this morning who knows what it feels like to have conflicting emotions, where you're in a bubble. It feels like you're in a maze. It feels like you're in a puzzle. Have you ever been in that moment where you know what to do, but then you find yourself saying, if I do this, then will it affect here? If I say this, will it affect that? If I do this, will it make people look at me differently? So the conflicting emotions that John is dealing with in our text is what's real in what you and I face every day in our lives. It's conflicting emotions because you feel trapped on the inside. You're afraid to say anything. You're afraid to do anything because it seems as if we live in a judgmental world where people look at us and judge and don't even know your name. But grab your neighbor and remind them that I'm in conflict. Conflict, not only conflicting. John is in conflicting because the disciples was glad to see Jesus, but knew that it was their last time. They were conflicting because they had been with Jesus. And now, being that they were with Jesus, they knew what he was capable of doing. They seen him feed the hungry. They watched him clothe the naked. They seen him give sight to the blind. And now they are going to be left what appears to be alone when he leaves. Oh, it's good to have security and knowing when somebody is there. But what do you do when they leave? And we got security while they are with us. But what happens when they are no longer around us? Have you ever felt comfortable with your security blanket, knowing that whenever you are with certain people that you feel secure, that you feel safe, but just as soon as they leave or go out of town or don't call for a few days, or you don't see them walking in their house because it becomes a challenge. And so John and the disciples are in a challenging moment, and you are still at the table with one person who you know is about to betray you. You have Jesus and the disciples at the table. And while at the table, there's 12 of the disciples, and one of the persons who's sitting at the table is going to betray Jesus. And so at this conflicting scene, Jesus knows what's next for him, and he still have to deal with one and or two people who are really not for him in the beginning. But Jesus still has to show compassion, and he still has to show integrity. And I don't know who I'm preaching to this morning, but there are so many times in our lives where we sit at the table and we know for a fact that we are sitting beside someone who don't even like us, and we're sitting beside another person who talks about us. We're sitting beside one person who act like they love you, and then you're sitting beside another person who just say stuff just to be saying it, to hope that you forget about what the conflict was. And so Jesus is sitting in the middle of Judas, who was sitting, and then the one who would be betraying him. And let me tell you, my friends, betrayal is a real thing. And so Jesus tells them, because when you look at verse 2, the Bible says, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas to betray him. That grabbed me, friends, because whenever you read that the devil had put
put in the heart of Judas to betray him. Judas, who was a called disciple. Judas, who was one that was picked out. Judas, who knew Jesus. Judas, who walked with Jesus. Judas, who knew all of Jesus's highs and lows, was going to betray him because the enemy had grabbed his heart. Let me tell somebody this morning, protect your heart. Let me say that again. Protect your heart. Y'all didn't hear me. Let me say that loud enough. Protect your heart. You got to protect your heart, because your heart is the only thing that you really have total control over. Your heart is the last thing that you want to give somebody who hadn't earned it. Your heart is the last thing that you want to show people who don't even appreciate it. And so their heart was grabbed. Satan had grabbed the heart of Judas, and Judas had turned so much so that he was willing to betray Jesus for a little bit of money. I wish I had some help in here. It's amazing what people would do just to get their way in this life. It's amazing the things people would say just to get their way in America. It's amazing. Anybody in here know that you are dealing in this world with people who will betray you just because, without reason or without cause? Anybody ever been betrayed? Anybody ever been taught? Anybody ever been used like a doormat, walked all over, walked all in? But anybody know that your heart has to be protected? Because anything that may drive you away from God, the heart is very sacred. The heart is very sacred. The heart is the place where the Holy Ghost resides. Woo, preach, blanks, preach, I'm doing the best I can. The heart is the place where the Holy Spirit resides. And so if you don't protect your heart, then how can he live inside of something that he don't have control over? Let me say that again. How can he live in something that he doesn't have full control over? When your family got more control over your heart than God, that's a problem. When your money got more control over you than God, that's a problem. When your careers have more control over you than God, that's a problem. When your desire to be first, when your desire to be on top all the time and never know how to handle being the bottom, that's a problem. Whenever you gotta always be in the front and don't know how to handle being in the back, when you always gotta be a leader and don't know how to be a follower, that's a problem. And so the heart is the place where the Lord says, I need to dwell in. I need it. Tell your neighbor, he needs your heart more than your mouth. But tell somebody, he needs your heart more than he needs your mouth. Because if he has your heart, he'll guard your mouth. Have I got a witness? If he has your heart, John gives a testimony. He gives a testimony. And then in verse 21, when Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in his spirit and testified. Jesus was troubled in his spirit and testified. And everyone started looking and said, Lord, is it? Sitting at the table, about to take Holy Communion. And then when Jesus says, one will betray me, and the one who's going to betray me is not an outsider, but is one who dips his hand in the bowl. I can handle outside betrayal much better than I can internal. They ask, Lord, is it?
But wait, permit this expert witness to testify, and I think I'm gonna go ahead and deputize myself as the expert witness this morning, because there are so many times we point the finger at people. We point the finger and try to find fault, try to pass blame. Have you ever seen people do that? Maybe you've never been a recipient of that kind of stuff, but let me preach to the ones that has ever had their fingers pointed at them. Let me look at the hands of those who people just point their fingers, and every time something go wrong, they point their fingers at you. And every time stuff go backwards or sideways, they point their finger at you. Every time the water busts, they point their finger at you. Every time the car tears up, they point their fingers at you. And so they were pointing the finger and looking and saying, "Is it you? Is it you? Is it you?" Whenever we hate more than we help is you. When we take more than we give is you. And you ought to just grab somebody and don't let them go. Just say, "Neighbor, don't let it be you this time. Let it be somebody else. Let it be somebody else." Because as they ask the question, "Lord, is it I?" It's interesting that Jesus said he's here sitting with us. He's among us. He's here. You know him. You know him. I'm not going to call him out. You know who he is. And whenever the heat got hot, whenever, you know, folk who do wrong, they can't stay still, y'all. Y'all know what I'm talking about. They get kind of fidgety. You start asking them questions. I wish I had me some real folk in here. I've been there. They go ask you questions. You trying to get out of it. Y'all know him. Trying to get out of it, Judas just saying finds a way to slip out the door. Jesus says, "Wait a minute, Judas, before you leave, whatever you're going to do, do it quickly. Tell your neighbor, I know who the backstabbers are. I know who the ones hating on me. And just, I dare you to testify loud enough and say, whatever you're going to do, do it quickly." Jesus, when he excuses the guilty, he tells Judas to go and do what he's going to do quickly. And Judas is gone. And everyone knew where he was going. And they were sitting around waiting on Jesus' next move. And Jesus just says, "It's time that the Son of Man be glorified." It's a good time to give God the glory. Because in the world where people are pushing hate, no compassion, somebody has to glorify God. In the world that we live in, somebody got to lift them up. In this new age of millennial movements, somebody need to lift up the name of the Lord. Because we can lift up a lot of stuff. But anybody know that you was not called to do anything other than lift him up? Because if he is exalted, Jesus says the way that you will know that he is exalted is locked up in our text. And I'm almost done. When Jesus said, "I'm giving you a new commandment." That is that you love. Y'all read that other than me. Why do you say love who? Y'all better say that. Like, who do you say love who? He said love one another as I have. Yo, can somebody say that with me? Love one another as I have. What? Anybody know he loved you? Anybody know he loved you so much so that while supposed to be here, and the reality is we are all guilty of something, and we all
loving and the same love that Jesus showed you, you want to show it to somebody else, because you ain't all that, baby. You ain't made, you ain't crossed every T, you haven't dotted every I. And so if you can't love each other, there's no way that you can show the true love of what Jesus is saying to us in our text this morning. He says, love one who is one another. Who is one another? He says, by this, the people will know that you belong to him. He says, when you love one another, people will know that you are my disciple. Let me set the record clear this morning that it's easy to love those who we agree with. But it's a challenge to love those who we are in conflict with. It's easy to love people who will support, but you find it difficult to love people who seem to bump and seem to bump against what you believe. But they ain't got nothing to do with how you feel, because people will make it hard to love. And I got a witness in here. Some people are just miserable. Some people are just mean. And you know what I just now started to say, but I changed. We got company, so I ain't gonna cuss this morning. People are mean, and therefore we have a responsibility to love who one another. Jesus says, when you love people, you will show that you belong to him. And so saying that you love me and showing your love is two different things. People can say they love you all day, but until they show that they love you, that's a whole nother animal. Have anybody ever said, oh, I love you, I love you, they hug you? Y'all know what I'm talking about. We do it in church sometimes. We give some of them old fake hugs. Y'all know them old little pretty hugs, them old little patting hugs. That ain't no hug. If you can't hug somebody, wrap them up. Is not guilty of love. It should never be said that you are a Christian and you don't have love. When I was hungry, did you feed me? Lord, I feel like preaching now. When I was sick, did you visit me? When I was in prison, did you come see about me? Lord, when did we see you hungry? When did we see you sick? When did we see you thirsty? Jesus said, no, you didn't see me, but indirectly you saw me, because the way you treated the least, y'all know who the least are? The least, those who don't look like you, the ones who don't smell like you, the ones who don't talk like you, the ones who didn't grow up on your side of the neighborhood, are the ones that we treat like nobodies. But it's deeper than that. It's rooted deeper than that. Because people need to know that you are his disciples. And let me ask you a series of questions. What did you say this week that would challenge someone in their thinking about you and their love? How did you act this week? Did you act in a way that glorified God? Did you act in a way that would question the integrity of your love? Anybody in this house know that they will know we are Christians by our love. They will know we are Christians not by the eloquence of our speech, not by our ability to engage in conversation that might create chaos and confusion, but they will know we are Christians by the way that we love one another. Peter said, Lord, why can't I go where you are going? Jesus said, where I'm going, you can't go.
Peter said, you know I'm your man. He says, when everyone leaves you, I'll be there. And Peter was one of Jesus' closest disciples. I mean, right along with James and John. Peter, he did defend Jesus in the garden. Peter, who did follow Jesus in the court after he was arrested. But Peter was not going to be faithful, because Jesus said, will you lay your life down for me? Peter couldn't answer that question. And he says, you know I love you, Jesus. You know I will. And Jesus says, Peter, I'm kind of concerned about that, because you said you would lay your life down for me. But whenever the going gets tough and the hills get hard to climb, will you really do what you said? And I wonder, is there anybody in this house this morning that can testify that people really want to know that you're going to do what you said? Your people really want to know that when they see you, that they see Jesus and not something that's not exemplifying the love of Christ. I need to preach to the folk who are in love with Jesus, because if you're in love with him, it's not going to be a challenge for you to love anybody else. If you love Jesus, if you've been born again, if you've been saved, you're not going to roll your eyes at sister so-and-so. If you love Jesus, you're not going to throw, y'all going to hit me in this house, you're not going to whisper under your breath about brother so-and-so. But what you're going to do is love the hell out of them anyway, even if they don't want to be loved. Love them anyhow, because you're not responsible for how they treat you, but you're responsible for how you treat them. And don't ever let it be said that you didn't love anybody. I knew it wasn't going to be no shout message, but I got to tell the truth this morning. A few years ago, when I did my first drive to New York, never drove in my life that far. My good friend Gordon Griffin had told me, he asked me rather, he said, Blanks, won't you just ride with me to New York? I need to go pick up a car. We drove to New York, and I had no clue, because I was a young driver, had no clue that you had to pay tolls. Y'all gonna hit me close in there. Didn't know we had to pay tolls. And what scared me half to death was while we were driving, I looked up and I saw on this turnpike that says, stay in your lane. And cars was driving. And I was nervous, afraid, and somehow the Lord helped me to get through the tunnel, because I thought I was going to lose it in that tunnel, because it seemed like everything was closing in on me. Finally got out of the tunnel. I'm shaking, and the phone rings, and it's Gordon, and he says, Blanks. He says, now, I want you to stay close by me, because we got to go through the tolls. And he said, not unless you got some money. I said, man, you know I'm broke. I'm pastor of a little small church in the hole. You know I ain't got no money. And he said, well, stay close by me. And when we got to the toll, I don't know what Gordon said to the man who was taking the money, but all I know is that as we were driving, I heard Gordon pull his hand out of the window and just waved me on. And whenever I got to Gordon and we stopped, I said, Gordon, what happened at the toll? He says, well, I told you to stay close with me, because I knew that you didn't have what it took to make it through the toll. So I wanted you to stay close with me. And so I just told the man that this car that's behind me is with me, and so just let him go past. That's all I'm trying to tell you this morning, is that some of us look like we're mad, and some of us look like that we can just rip anybody. We look like we're just angry with the world, but just stay close to somebody who will put joy in your heart. Stay close by somebody that'll love you even when you feel unlovable. You gotta stay close by somebody who will help you even when you're helpless. You gotta stay close by somebody who, no matter about the color of your skin, they ain't worried about
going to school, ain't worried about what kind of degrees you got. The only thing he wants to know is, did you love anybody? Did you help anybody? The song I love is, I can just help somebody as I pass along. If I can just cheer somebody with a word or a song, then my living will not be in vain. Let me help somebody who may not know what I'm trying to get over to you. Just look somebody in the eye and say, neighbor, it's not about how much money you got. It's not about what kind of car you drive. But it's about, do you love your neighbor? Ask yourself, who is my neighbor? My neighbor is sitting beside me. And just wrap them up and say, you are my neighbor. And I love you. Men of every birth for an answer. Jesus gave a key and said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. Have I got a witness? Have I got a witness? And let me tell you, if they don't love you back, don't worry about them. You just know that you are child of the King. Let me look at the ones who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. See, if you are saved, it won't matter. You will bless his name. Anybody in here glad that he loves you? He loves you. He loves you. I don't care what they're doing in Charlotte. You just make sure that you love everybody. Type of protest they're having in Charlotte. You don't be guilty of falling in the trap of all this social media. You be a Christian. You walk with your head up high and you show that you are saved and sanctified and filled with the Holy Ghost. Have I got a witness? I would preach this hard, but I done got happy now. Thinking about he loved me. He loved me. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones who hear me, Lord, they are weak, but he is strong. Have I got a witness? Have I got a witness? Won't you go find two or three people and don't let them go, but wrap them up and say, neighbor, neighbor, this is what true love feels like. It feels like this. And don't let them go. Don't let them go. Don't let them go. Wrap them up real tight. You might got to move, but if you got to move, get on out the aisle and go find two or three folk. Don't let them go. But tell them we love you. You are my disciple by your love, by your love. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? He walks with me, he talks with me, and tells me I am his own. And the joy, and the joy that we share. As we tarry there, none other has ever known. And I'm gonna close when I read you this part. And God knows I'm done. Though I speak with tongues of angels and of men and have not love, I am a sounding brass and a tingling cymbal. But the part I'm trying to get to is, when I was a child, I spake as a child. Child, I understood as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things, and now abideth faith, hope, charity, these three, but the greatest is love. Tell your neighbor.
I'm done. God bless you. Enough evidence to be convicted. Love one another. That's just the message. Love one another. That's it. That's it. And love people the way you want to be loved. Treat people the way you want to be treated. And they will know you are his disciple. You won't have to work around with a cross around your neck. You won't have to convince people that you were saved. They will know it. They will know it. Teach them to love one another and let them fall by the side of the road. Teach them. Somebody will come walk with you. They'll walk with you because they will know what it is to be saved and live in an upside down world. They'll walk with you because they will know what it is to be in a world that we have to live in together and deal with people who don't even know Jesus and will laugh at the fact that you do. But that's not a lonely walk, because he'll walk with you. Surely goodness and mercy to follow me all the days of my life, and I will live.
in the house of the Lord forever. Let me give you this next invitation, friend. If you're here, you're saying, you know what? It's not that I don't know him, but I found myself drifting from him. Drifting from the foundational principles that I came to Christ in and knowing and standing on. The one principle being love one another. Maybe you've drifted away from God, but guess what? He's not that far away that you can't reach out. And as you reach, his hand will connect with your hand. And very deeply, stay within. But sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard your despairing cry from the waters lifted me. Now saved am I. The last invitation goes to you, or the third invitation goes to you if you are seeking a church home. We're not a perfect church, we're a praying church. But this is a great church. It's a fun church. It's a place that God is changing by the help of you. He's changing it because you are helping shape an atmosphere of love and support. And maybe you don't have that place. Maybe you need that place. Won't you come join and grow with us here at the Rockin' Church? Won't you come? That's you, friend. This last invitation is extended for those who need to just pray and ask God through the word that he spoke to us today to search me, O God. Search my mode in motion. Search my motive. Search me, God. And when you find it, take it out, for I want to be right. I want to be whole. And if you just need to come and kneel and pray because you're dealing with some internal stuff that you look good on the outside, but inside is tearing you up, you just need to kneel and pray. I wouldn't wait on my neighbor. I wouldn't wait on the first person. You come on and go to God in prayer for yourself. Maybe you're dealing with some things that is challenging you because you want to do God's will, but you know that there's that something that's holding you hostage from really, 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 truly loving people the way that we ought to. If that's you, won't you come? Won't you come? Won't you come? Here's love.